4, Matthew chapter 4, and we're going to look at the Lord Jesus Christ and how he launches his public ministry in an area that you would think wouldn't be the area to start his public ministry. He's going to begin his ministry in an area called Galilee of the Gentiles. And there's some strategic reasons why he does that. It's actually an act of judgment when the Lord is not going to begin his ministry, public ministry, I should say, in Jerusalem and in the southern portion of Judea, but rather he's going to launch it further north, quite north for that matter. So I am going to refer to the map that I've drawn over my shoulder. So bear with me as we will read the passage. I'll say some things about the diagram, and then we'll look at some interesting types. And that's what I really wanted to focus on, is a few of the types that we can recognize as we read the passage. So anyway, Matthew chapter 4, and let's pick it up, or let's begin reading at verse 12. Okay, Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. Now when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the sea coast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Our Father, once again, we pray that our time together in study of your word would prove to be enlightening, and may we certainly identify your wisdom and the outworking of your plan via the ministry of your beloved Son as he presents himself to be Israel's Messiah. We again pray that we would have this understanding. May we always guard against confusing our identity with the people that you are dealing with specifically in the Gospels, the nation of Israel. May we, by applying the principle of right division, have a clear understanding of who we are and what it is you're doing today, in distinction with what it was you were doing with the nation of Israel during the messianic ministry of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, may our time together prove to be profitable, and we ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in his name we pray. Amen. Real quick, if you allow me to just refer to the diagram, the map. This is not to scale, okay, because we're going to be looking at the area that the Lord Jesus Christ is conducting his ministry. So this is not to scale. I kind of compress things just a little bit to squeeze it all in. This is the area that is what is often called the Promised Land, although the Promised Land actually extends much further south and much further north. But the region where the Lord Jesus is going to begin his ministry is here in the Upper Galilean area. Okay, now this is the Sea of Galilee. This is the Jordan River. It runs southward into the Salt Sea, also known as the Dead Sea. Okay. Now, if you go west of the Dead Sea, about 25 miles, you have Jerusalem. So the star with the J, that's Jerusalem. We're all familiar with that. The Mediterranean Sea is further west. Now, this pinkish area represents Judah or Judea, okay? And Judah, historically, was the southern kingdom. And if you're familiar with Israel's history, the 10 northern tribes were separated from the two faithful tribes in the south. So historically, you have the north and the south. That southern area of Judea is where Jerusalem is. As you travel northward, you now enter into an area called Galilee. There is an area called Lower Galilee and Upper Galilee. We're not going to concern ourselves with that. We have Samaria, where the Lord is going to conduct the work of ministry. What we want to point out is this. Notice in verse 13, and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the sea coast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali. Okay? Now, let me just point this out. There is this area called Zebulun. There were 12 tribes. One of the 12 tribes that was given to one of the 12 sons is Zebulun. Okay? Now, we're going to point out there are two cities that we're going to take note of, all right? There's Nazareth, the southern edge of Zebulun, and then there's Cana, the northern edge of Zebulun. But then we also learn in the verse that there's another area called Naphtalium. Naphtalium is north of Zebulun. It's northwest of the Sea of Galilee. And Naphtalium actually extends further north into this area called Syria. Okay? So Galilee would encompass this northern area that would include Zebulun, obviously, and it includes Naphtali. Capernaum, by the way, is at the very northern tip of the Sea of Galilee. That's where Peter, that's where the Lord Jesus is going to call out all of his disciples. Interestingly enough, all of the Lord's disciples are from Galilee. They're from the north. Only one disciple was from the south, from Judah, and that was Judas, hence the name Judas. There was a strategic reason for the Lord Jesus Christ to do that. Now, what do we want to be aware of? What we want to be aware of is this. The southern portion of the land of Israel, the land of Palestine, hated the northern realm. They hated Galilee. They hated the Samaritans. Those Jews, it's called Jewry in the book of John. The Lord Jesus, he's not going to commence his ministry in the area of Jewry. That is, the area that was assumed to be the most faithful. The area that you would assume the Lord Jesus Christ would launch his ministry is not where he launches his ministry. He's going to actually begin his ministry in an area that is despised, an area that is looked upon with tremendous disdain by the religious leadership in Judah, the southern area of the Promised Land. Notice again how this area is described. Verse 15, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtalium, by the way of the sea, that would be the Sea of Galilee, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The reason the apostate nation of Israel, the Jewry in the south, hated the north, and they held the Galilean Jews as not truly being Jews, but there was this animosity, was because they were considered as Gentiles, okay? When the verse says Galilee of the Gentiles, that's how a Jew in Jerusalem would have viewed someone in this region, okay? So the Lord Jesus, he deliberately begins in Galilee of the Gentiles, the area that is despised and held in tremendous disdain. Notice verse 16, the people which sat in darkness saw great light. So the Lord Jesus, he's not going to begin in the land of Jewry. He's going to go to an area that is under the grip of satanic darkness. And when we follow through some of the verses, the darkness has everything to do with the satanic policy of evil that has cast this covering of ignorance on the Gentiles, okay? But what we discover historically is that there are Jews up there. The Lord Jesus, he is rescuing the Jews that are under the influence and under the effect of the darkness and the policy of evil that is gripping and holding in spiritual bondage God's people. And that's what the Lord Jesus is now doing. And it is an act of judgment against the nation of Israel. He's condemning the south by simultaneously shedding light on the north, okay? But we're not going to deal with those particulars yet. The first thing that we want to point out, verse 15, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtalium, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. There are commentaries that will insist that what Jesus is doing, he's launching a ministry to the Gentiles. And that is a grave mistake, because Jesus is not launching his ministry to the Gentiles. Rather, he launches his ministry in an area called Galilee of the Gentiles. You know the difference, right? Galilee of the Gentiles or to the Gentiles. He's in an area that historically is called Galilee of the Gentiles because it is occupied and was occupied historically, principally by the Gentiles. And historically, what you discover is that these Gentiles, which actually takes you back to Assyria, Babylon, so forth and so on, the Jews that lived in this Galilean region, racially, religiously, economically, politically, culturally, ethnically, and geographically, they were heavily influenced by Gentile rule and dominion. What Jesus is doing is he's springing out the light among the Jews that are under the dark rule and grip of this Gentile occupation. But Jesus is not preaching to the Gentiles. Critically important. How do we know that? A couple of verses. Go to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. We'll go back to Matthew 4. Matthew chapter 10. Notice Matthew chapter 10 and verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded. This is not a suggestion, right? Commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of who? Israel. So, wait a minute. How can anyone suggest that what Jesus is doing in Matthew 4 is he is going to preach the gospel to the Gentiles when he clearly says, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel? Go over to chapter 15. Go to Matthew chapter 15. And notice here in Matthew chapter 15, and look there at verse 24. Now, the context, maybe we will look at the context, but just notice verse 24. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Well, who's he talking to? Look there at verse 22. And behold, a woman, actually look at verse 21. Then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. Tyre and Sidon, again, up here in the northwestern area of Galilee. Galilee of the Gentiles. Keep that that city Tyre in mind, because we're going to go to a verse in the Old Testament and there's going to be a king from Tyre that's going to inherit this entire area. And it's going to eventually fall to the hands of the Assyrians. But anyway, Jesus, he's up there in the coast of Tyre and Sidon. Verse 22, and behold, a woman of Canaan. Now, keep your finger here. Go to Mark chapter 7. Mark is going to supply more detail in identifying who this woman is. Mark chapter 7, and if we notice there, verse 24, Mark chapter 7, verse 24, and from thence he arose and went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and entered into an house, and would have no man known it, but he could not be hid. For a certain woman, whose young daughter had an unclean spirit, heard of him, and came and fell at his feet. This woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician. By ethnically, she's a Greek. Nationally, she's Syrophoenician. You see the word Syro? Syria. She's of Syrian nationality. Now, historically, is Syria a friend of Israel? Syria is not a friend of Israel. Syria persistently harassed. Syria, as well as all of the other Gentile influences and nations, they would launch incursions into Israel. They would have conflict with the Israelis. Ultimately, they would hold and take captive Israelis. So just remember, this woman ethnically is a Greek, and by nationality, we read there at verse 26, a Syro-Phoenician by nation. Okay? Now, go back to Matthew, only because Matthew, I think, will do what I would like it to do for this evening. Anyway, go Matthew back to Matthew chapter 15 and verse 22. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. Now think about that. A Greek Syrophoenician whose origins, whose nationality takes you back to Syria. What is she calling him? Son of David. In other words, even though she's a Gentile, she's aware of not only who he is, but ultimately what he's doing. Keep reading, my daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. Lord, she's bugging the daylights out of us. Tell her to get lost. He won't even, and then he says to the disciples, verse 24, but he answered who? The disciples. And said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Didn't I tell you guys previously, Matthew chapter 10, don't go to the Gentiles, go rather to who? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. Verse 25, then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to what? Dogs. Now, that's rather harsh. You're a Gentile, specifically a Greek, Syrophoenician, and I'm not sent to you. I'm sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And it is not fitting. It is not appropriate for the Lord Jesus as Messiah at this time to, as he describes it, to take the children's bread. The children's bread, by the way, is the gospel of the kingdom. Okay, that's the children's bread. How do we know that, by the way? If you go to Mark chapter 7, I really didn't intend to spend time here, but in Matthew chapter Mark chapter 7, verse 27, but Jesus said unto her, let the children first be filled, for it is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it unto dogs. What is Jesus doing first among the children? What he's doing first is he's preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Now, quickly going back to Matthew chapter 15, verse 27, she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. This woman, Greek Syrophoenician, she comes by faith, identifying him as the son of David. He is heir to the throne of David. You are Messiah. And not only that, as a Gentile, I come looking for the crumbs that are going to fall from the table. Yes, the bread belongs to the children of Israel. The gospel of the kingdom, the hope and the promise of this literal kingdom to be established on the earth, that was something that God promised the nation of Israel. And as a Gentile, she knows, listen, as soon as this nation is installed as a royal priesthood, as a kingdom of priests, we know that the blessings of that Davidic covenant, it's going to trickle down to the dogs. And you know what Jesus does? Wow, that's faith. Too bad Israel didn't exercise that level of understanding and that level of faith. So what does Jesus do? He heals the daughter, right? There's one other Gentile that the Lord Jesus heals. And Tell you what, why don't we go there? Might as well get this out of the way. Go to Luke chapter 7. There's another Gentile. My point is this. The verses are very clear. Jesus didn't go to Galilee of the Gentiles for the purpose of reaching Gentiles, teaching Gentiles, preaching to Gentiles. He's looking for the lost sheep that are scattered in an area that is dominated and occupied by the Gentiles, gripped by the Gentile influence, under the bondage of darkness. And what's Jesus doing? He's shining the light. He's calling the sheep to come out of the darkness. Come to the light. Now, here's the other Gentile, okay? Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7, verse 2, okay? And a certain centurion's servant, who was dear unto him, was sick and ready to die. And when he heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the who? The Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought him instantly and said that he was worthy for whom he should do this. For he loveth our nation, and he hath built us a synagogue. So what was the means of approach exercised by a centurion? He understands something about the relationship between the God of the universe and the nation of Israel, so much so that he, as the verse tells us, loves our nation and builds a synagogue. They that bless thee, I will bless. The Abrahamic covenant. Jesus is going to honor the centurion's request to heal the servant because he's qualified. He's a qualified Gentile. Only because he blessed the nation of Israel. He loves Israel, he loves the nation, and he built a synagogue. For that reason, so the two Gentiles that we have record of Jesus having direct interaction with, the first one, the Greek Syrophoenician, she exercised faith. She approached the Lord Jesus as a Gentile dog, and Jesus honors her request. The other Gentile loves the nation, builds a synagogue. He understands the Abrahamic covenant, and I'm blessing the people of Israel. So what does Jesus do? Then I'll bless you in return. Those are the only two Gentiles, okay? So in light of all of that, let's go to John. Now, let's notice something in John. Just remember, Galilee of the Gentiles, because his people are scattered among Gentiles. That's a bad arrangement. Israel was not supposed to be scattered among the Gentiles. And there's reason for why they're all scattered. But go over to John chapter 4 and just notice the hatred between the south and the north, between Judah and Galilee of the Gentiles. John chapter 4 and verse, 3. Look at verse 3. He left Judea and departed again, here we go, into Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Okay, verse 7. Then cometh the woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. So question, why is he having interaction with this woman? Samaria is in this northern area. You can't get into Zebulun unless you go through Samaria, okay? The Jews of the south, they didn't like the Samaritans. Verse 9, then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, asketh drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the, here we go, Samaritans. Now, is this woman a Jew or is she a Gentile? She's a Jew, but she's a Samaritan Jew. Drop down to verse 12. Notice there, verse 12. Art thou greater than our father who? Jacob. You see her descent? She's a descendant of Jacob. Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave, here we go, us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Drop down to verse 20. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. So wait a minute. There's something very special about this woman. She's a descendant of Jacob. Verse 25. Look at verse 25. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. So here you have a Jew, a descendant of Jacob, who understands the program, knows that Messiah is coming, whether it's Isaiah, doesn't matter, and she understands that Messiah is called the Christ, and what's he do? Jesus has this encounter with a Samaritan woman, but she's not a Gentile. She's a Jew. But I want to just reiterate something. Notice once again verse 9. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. You're Galilee of the Gentiles. You're not of pure blood. You're not of pure Jewish religion. You have cross-marriaging and you have interaction. And again, the political, the cultural, the ethnic, the religious, the economic, it's all influenced and tainted by the Gentiles. The South had no affection for these northern Jews that are considered Gentile. Okay? So, when we begin looking at Matthew chapter 4, Galilee of the Gentiles. Let's go back to Matthew 4 and let's now look at some specifics. Go back to Matthew 4. He goes to Galilee of the Gentiles to rescue the lost sheep, those that are hated. By the way, isn't that typical God? You know, when Paul writes, for example, God, he doesn't choose the wise, he chooses the foolish. He doesn't choose the mighty, he chooses the weak. He doesn't choose the honorable, he chooses the base. You know what God does? He begins his ministry by focusing in on the outcast, the refuge, the ones that are discarded, the ones that are abandoned, the ones that are hated. That's where God begins his ministry. Not down in the South, where you have the self-righteous, pious, religious apostasy. They thought they were the children of God. And you know what Jesus said to these guys? You're of your father who? The devil. He's going to rescue the lost sheep, beginning in the north, okay? Now, Matthew chapter 4, and notice verse 15. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtalium. By the way, to the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. Historically, let's look at a little bit of history. We've got the map. We're going to go into the Old Testament. Historically, what can we learn about Galilee? Historically, what can we learn about Zebulun? Historically, what can we learn about Naphtalian? And what's Jesus doing there? Okay, let's just look at the history of Galilee. Go over to 1 Kings chapter 9. Go to 1 Kings chapter 9. And here we learn something about Galilee. 1 Kings chapter 9 and beginning at verse 10. Okay, 1 Kings chapter 9 and verse 10. Verse 10, 1 Kings chapter 9. And it came to pass at the end of 20 years when Solomon had built the two houses, the house of the Lord and the king's house. Now notice verse 11. Now Hiram the king of Tyre. Remember, Tyre is up here, northwest quadrant of Galilee. Okay. Verse 11, now Hiram, the king of Tyre, had furnished Solomon with cedar trees and fir trees with gold, according to all his desire. That then King Solomon gave Hiram 20 cities in the land of what? Galilee. What did King Solomon just give a Gentile king? 20 cities in the land of already there's a problem here. Why are you giving over land to the Gentile. Hiram is a Gentile king. So we already see the roots, the origin of Galilee is when Solomon handed it over to the Gentile king. Verse 12, and Hiram came out from Tyre to see the cities which Solomon had given him. And they pleased him not. And he said, what cities are these which thou hast given me, my brother? And he called them the land of Kabul unto this day. Kabul means worthless. Kabul means nothing. Kabul means displeasing. Kabul means dirt. So already a Gentile king is given these cities in Galilee. And what does the Gentile king, how does he view this? It's worthless. Now spiritually, that's exactly the sentiment that the South had towards the worthless. There's nothing there. There's nothing of value. Now go to 2 Kings chapter 15. Go to 2 Kings chapter 15. And notice there, 2 Kings chapter 15 and verse 29. 2 Kings chapter 15 and verse 29. In the days of Pekah, king of Israel, came Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria, and took Ajon and Abelbeth-Micah and Genoa and Kadesh and Hazar and Gilead and Galilee, all the land of Naphtali. That would be Naphtalium in Matthew chapter 4. Look at the end of verse 29. And carried them captive into Assyria. So what does the king of Assyria do? He invades this area. He takes Galilee. He takes those cities in Galilee. And not only does he take the Jews that are occupying the land, and he brings them northeast into Assyria, into Assyrian captivity, guess who now is occupying the land? If the king takes out the Jew, he then replaces them with his own people. Now we begin to see the Assyrian influence. And historically, for sake of time, where does all of this Baal worship? Where does all of this star worship? Where does all of the paganism and idolatry that God didn't like the Assyrians, and that's a gross understatement. Who is occupying God's land? Who is holding his people in captivity? Who is occupying the city? Those are the three principal issues throughout God's Old Testament program. Who's in my land? Who's having authority over my people? And who's exercising governmental control in my city, Jerusalem? Okay. Galilee is now in Gentile captivity, specifically the Assyrians, okay? Let's look at, go to Judges chapter 1. Just look at some things, the history of Zebulun and the history of Naphtalium, okay? Now, in the book of Joshua, if you remember Joshua, we go to Judges chapter 1. If you remember the history of Joshua, you have this new Israel, this new generation of Israelites that now cross the Jordan River. They now enter into the land of Canaan, and they now begin to vanquish all of the Gentiles. You have this record of all of Israel's conquest, and they're now evicting, if you will, Gentile occupation. So after a series of wars and a series of defeats over all of these Gentiles, Israel now occupies the land. So Israel now is given lots of inheritance. The land is going to be divided into 12 sections. Zebulun and Naphtalium are two areas that were given as a lot of inheritance, okay? So when we get to Judges chapter 1, notice in Judges chapter 1, verse 30, Judges 1, verse 30. Neither did Zebulun drive out the inhabitants of Kitron, nor the inhabitants of Nahalol, but the Canaanites dwelt among them and became tributaries. Wait a minute. What did God tell Israel to do with those Gentiles? Get them off the land. This is my land. I'm giving it to you. For various reasons, there were a number of tribes. They didn't completely eradicate. They didn't completely evict the Gentiles. That becomes a problem. A problem that now, sadly, will plague Israel for the rest of her history. Why didn't you get... Now, we're not going to deal with that. Remember when God... You know, skeptics and unbelievers, they'll accuse God of being a bloodthirsty animal, because there were times when God said, when you invade that city, you spare no one. You kill them all. And that at times included children. So again, there's this misunderstanding, this wrong perception that God is just a bloodthirsty animal. There's a reason why God would tell Israel, you spare no one. Well, what did Zebulun do? They allowed the Canaanites to stay in the land. What ultimately happened? Does Israel begin to influence the Canaanites, or are the Canaanites in their land going to influence the Israelites? The latter, sadly. Drop down to verse 33. Neither did Naphtali... That would be Naphtalium in Matthew 4. Neither did Naphtali drive out the inhabitants of Beth Shemesh, nor the inhabitants of Beth Anath, but he dwelt among the Canaanites, the inhabitants of the land. Nevertheless, the inhabitants of Beth Shemesh and of Beth Anath became tributaries unto them. Instead of driving them out, they assess taxes. That's what a tributary is. Well, okay, instead of getting rid of all of them, then you know what? We'll just make them pay taxes. Dumb motive not to drive out those Gentiles, right? So just be aware, wait a minute. Now all of a sudden you have the history of Gentile influence, okay? Now, let's go over to Genesis chapter 3. I want to just notice the typology when we go back to Matthew 4, but first go to Genesis chapter 30, okay? Genesis chapter 30. The first area that Matthew 4 describes is Zebulun, okay? The first time we learn about Zebulun, Genesis chapter 30, notice there at verse, the story of Leah. Leah didn't have any children, so finally Leah is going to have a child, right? Now, notice verse 19, Genesis 30, verse 19, and Leah conceived again and bare Jacob the sixth son. And Leah said, God hath endued me with a good dowry. Now will my husband dwell with me, because I have borne him six sons. And she called his name Zebulun. That name Zebulun comes from Zabal, which means to dwell. Just think about that. Verse 20 again. Now will my husband dwell with me. That's the name Zebulun or Zebulun. So I just want you to notice something. Go back to Matthew chapter 4. Go back to Matthew chapter 4. The Lord Jesus Christ, he's living... Notice in Matthew chapter 2, go to Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, verse, now you remember what happens in Matthew chapter 2, right? The announcement of the birth of the king, he's born in Bethlehem, okay? Jesus is born in Bethlehem, and now that King Herod, he issues the command to kill all the children 2 years old and under. So in a dream, Joseph is warned to escape to Egypt. So, the family, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, they escape to Egypt until Herod dies. After Herod dies, the angel now tells them to head back, but notice where they're going to go. Matthew chapter 2. 2:22, but when he heard that Archelaus did reign in Judea in the room of his father Herod, he was afraid to go thither, notwithstanding being warned of God in a dream. He turned aside into the parts of Galilee, and he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth. God is now going to send his son to Galilee, that hated region that is viewed with disdain by the hypocritic, self-righteous Jews in the south. And he's now going to dwell, the word dwell, in Nazareth. Verse 23, and he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth. Think about this, is at the southern edge of Zebulun. What does Zebulun mean? My husband will be pleased to dwell with me. Now think about the ultimate prophecies that are going to come to pass. Jesus is about 2 years old. Let's say 3 years. Either way, Jesus lives in Zebulun, the city of Nazareth, for 28, 27 years. He's living in an area called My Husband Will Be Pleased to Dwell with Me. Now, you know who Jesus Christ is ultimately going to marry. You're familiar with Revelation chapter 21. New Jerusalem comes down. And what is New Jerusalem called? The Lamb, the bride's, the Lamb's wife. Go to Hosea. The Lord Jesus Christ, in type, chooses to dwell for 27, 28 years in an area that means my husband will be pleased to dwell with me. There's a promise that God makes in Hosea to the nation of Israel. We read in Hosea chapter 2, look there at verse 14, Hosea chapter 2 and verse 14, therefore, behold, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. And I will give her her vineyards from thence and the valley of Achor for a door of hope. And she shall sing there as in the days of her youth, as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Aisha and shalt call me no more Baali. Now, Aisha, that means my husband. If you glance back to verse 2 real quick, verse 2, plead with your mother, plead, for she is not my wife, neither am I her husband. Let her therefore put away her whoredoms out of her sight and her adulteries from between her breasts. Listen, this whole area was abandoned. Israel was abandoned. She became apostate, committing spiritual whoredom by practicing idolatry. God says, I'm going to divorce you. And God did divorce the nation of Israel. And what the Lord promises, one day you're going to call me my husband. Look there at verse 16 again. And it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Aisha, and shall call me no more Baali, for I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. And in that day will I make a covenant for them. Drop down to verse 19. And I will betroth thee unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness and in judgment and loving kindness and in mercies. I will even betroth thee unto me in faithfulness. This is fascinating. Israel has gone apostate. Jesus literally lives, he dwells in an area that means God, my husband, is pleased to dwell with me. It's as though Jesus, he is now ready to marry his bride. And here's something else that's fascinating. Go to John chapter 2. Go to John chapter 2. The very first miracle that Jesus Christ performs. Anybody remember? A wedding. Now, let's look at the passage. John chapter 2. Verse 1, John chapter 2, verse 1. And the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of where? Galilee. Now, do you know where Cana is? Cana is located at the northernmost edge of Zebulun. My husband is pleased to dwell with me. Here you have Jesus, who's dwelt there in the city for, like I said, 28 years or so. The very first miracle that he performs is in a city in Zebulun, and it just so happens that it happens at a marriage ceremony. Is that just a coincidence? Again, the typology, it's just fascinating, okay? Now, go back to Matthew chapter 4. I think it's just exciting to see what Jesus Christ is doing. He is now going to reverse all of the chastisements and all of the punishments. He is now going to challenge the adversary. He's going to take back what is rightfully his. He's going to take back the land that's rightfully his, and he's going to take back his wife, Israel, that is rightfully his. And he's moving in this particular area, demonstrating who he is based upon some prophecies that were foretold about what God is going to do. Okay, here's one other real quick. Matthew chapter 4. Now, Naphtalium, verse 15. The land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtalium. Naphtalium would be north and east. The north, just northeast of Zebulun, is Naphtalium. That includes this area of Capernaum. Naphtalium means my struggle. Here's something interesting. The first record of Jesus having any dialogue with unclean spirits, the devils. Now, my struggle. If you study the gospel record, Jesus had more encounters in this area than anywhere else. Do you remember the first time he speaks to one of these devils? Just for sake of time, I'll tell you what's going on. There's this area, the Gergesenes, the Gadarenes, so on and so forth. That's right there, just south east of Capernaum, okay? They get off the ship. They're on the Sea of Galilee. There was a supernatural storm, a supernatural wind. Satan is trying to kill Jesus, okay? So anyway, there's this supernatural storm. What does Jesus do? He just calms the waters. They get off on the other side, and immediately they run into these devils, and these guys are fierce. And do you remember what Jesus said? What's your name? Or who are you? And what was the name? My name is Legion, for we are many. My struggle. The Lord Jesus, he's cleaning up the land. He is engaged in spiritual battle against these forces, the stronghold of Satan himself, that has now polluted the realm via devils and unclean spirits. So it's just fascinating. The encounters that Jesus has happens to be in an area called my struggle. He is engaged in spiritual combat with the adversary. And you remember the rest of the story. Legion, we are many. They even said, what dost thou have to do, son of David? And then you remember, all they asked was, don't cast us out of the land. Okay? There's a herd of swine, and they entered into the swine. And then, of course, there's a cliff, and all of these swine, they drown in the Sea of Galilee. Okay? Here's another type. We'll just do this extremely quick. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 18. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Now, this is fascinating. There is some imagery here. Fishers, the concept of being a fisher of men actually is found in the Old Testament. This is, to me, this is so fascinating. The Lord Jesus is calling his disciples to do something that did happen in Israel's history. Go over to Jeremiah chapter 16. The language, it's not verbatim, I understand that, but the imagery is clear. And the Lord is borrowing this image. In Jeremiah chapter 16, verse 16, Jeremiah chapter 16, verse 16. Behold, I will send for many fishers, saith the Lord, and they shall fish them. And after will I send for many hunters, and they shall hunt them from every mountain and from every hill, out of the holes and the rocks. You know what Jeremiah is describing? The Babylonian captivity. In other words, my people, they're going to suffer the consequences of the fifth course of chastisement, and I'm going to send fishers, the Babylonians. The Babylonians, they're going to come in like fishermen and hunters, and they're going to pull the Israelites from the Sea of Israel, reeling them in into Babylonian captivity. God calls the Babylonians fishers. Isn't that interesting? Go over to Amos chapter 4. I'm sure everybody read the book of Amos the other day. Amos chapter 4. Again, the language and the imagery. Amos chapter 4, verse 2. The Lord God has sworn by his holiness that, lo, the day shall come upon you, that he will take you away with hooks, and your posterity with what? Fish hooks. This is the Assyrian captivity. The image is fascinating. You know what Satan, God is using Satan as an instrument of chastisement and punishment against his own people because they're the ones that violated the covenant. So God says, I'm going to send the Assyrians and they're going to come in like fishermen. They're going to come in like anglers and they're going to fish you out of my land and they're going to drag you into exile. One more verse in that regard, go to Habakkuk. I love that name, Habakkuk, a few books to the right. Habakkuk chapter 1. Habakkuk chapter 1, and look there at verse 14. Habakkuk chapter 1, and notice there verse 14. Habakkuk, he's crying out to the Lord. He's crying out because of verse 6. Look there at verse 6. For lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. The Chaldeans were southern Babylonians, okay? They're Babylonians, okay? What's God doing? I'm going to have to send the Chaldeans, the southern Babylonians, into the land. Doesn't belong to them, but I'm going to make them go into the land. Verse 14, and maketh men as the fishes of the sea, as the creeping things that have no ruler over them. They take up all of them with the angle. They catch them in their net and gather them in their drag. Therefore, they rejoice and are glad. Therefore, they sacrifice unto their net and burn incense unto their drag, because by them their portion is fat and their meat plenteous. Shall they therefore empty their net and not spare continually to slay the nations? You know what God is describing? The Babylonians, they're coming in and they are easily vanquishing all of the nations like a bunch of fishermen, and they're netting all of the occupants, and they're angling, and they're bringing these captives back into exile. You know what the Lord Jesus is saying to his disciples? We're going to turn the tables, gentlemen. Historically, Israel was fished into exile. You know what Jesus is doing? I'm going to fish my people out of exile. Satanic captivity, satanic oppression, satanic dominion. What Jesus is going to do, he's going to thwart the policy of evil. He's going to reverse the policy of evil. And what Jesus is going to do, he's going to call a corps of men who will go out there and capture people from the sea of nations, pulling them into the kingdom. Historically, it was the other way around. In judgment and chastisement, God sent fishermen to pull Israel out of the land. Jesus now, he's going to call up the nation of Israel to go out among the nations and pull people into his kingdom. Just fascinating. Again, the typology. When you just were talking to Kyle, you know, when you just begin to see things, the awesome, the splendor, wisdom of Almighty God. I guess bottom line is this. When you read the account of Messiah, what he's doing, what he's saying, where he goes, it's not just coincidence. You actually can discover such deep significance that at first on the surface, you may not identify it, but boy, you start to dig in and you can see God's fingerprints all over the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. I think that, to me, really is an exciting thing. Father, again, we thank you for your love and for your grace. We thank you that as we study the life and the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ, we certainly can rejoice knowing who he is and what it is he is seeking to do in fulfilling your prophetic purposes. Again, we thank you for your word. May we always rightly divide it. May we understand to whom it is written specifically regarding the messianic purposes. And as always, may we rejoice knowing who we are as a distinct entity, the church, the body of Christ. And we thank you for in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you for your patience.